Whether you need a disguise to run from the law, or are just trying to emulate NSYNC-era frosted tips, you may need some chemical assistance to put that hue in your do. So calling all bottled blondes and box brunettes, get ready to learn everything you're dying to know about the chemistry of artificial hair color. Human beings around the world have colored their hair since ancient times with vinegar, nutshells, berries, and even lead. Yikes. The story of salon hair color really has its roots in the history of modern chemistry. In 1907, French chemist Eugene Schuller marketed an artificial hair color formulation using paraphenylene diamine, or PPD, a compound still used in some hair dyes today. In fact, Schuller's company, the French Harmless Hair Dye Company, later became known as L'Oréal. To understand how today's hair color works, we'll need to review some basic hair anatomy. And no, I'm not talking about the mullet. Each strand of hair grows from a hair follicle, a surprisingly complex organ, complete with an erector feeling muscle that gives us goosebumps and a sebaceous gland that secretes oil. But all of that is what lies beneath the skin's surface. The visible part of hair, you know, the stuff you brush, braid, fade, or pull into a man bun, is known as the hair shaft. The shaft is covered by a layer of overlapping keratin cells called the cuticle, which protect and waterproof the inner layers of the hair. Non-permanent dyes that come in sprays and gels coat the cuticle, but usually fade after a few shampoos. To get that color to permanently last, we need to penetrate that cuticle and allow dye to reach an inner layer of the hair shaft called the cortex. The cortex contains more keratin, plus important pigment proteins called melanins, which give hair its natural color. To make this happen, salons bring out the big guns. That means developer, a fancy salon term for hydrogen peroxide mixed into a solution containing chemicals called primary intermediates, coupling compounds or couplers, and ammonia. The ammonia is responsible for some of those signature nostril tingling scents of hair dye and is also extremely basic, like platinum ombre on Stacy Basic. With a pH of over 11, the solution causes the entire hair shaft to swell. This separates the keratin cells that make up the cuticle and allow the dye molecules to seep into the cortex. And now for the main event. As our mixture penetrates the tens of thousands of hair shafts on your head, hydrogen peroxide lightens the natural pigment and takes away electrons from or oxidizes the dye's primary intermediate compounds. These chemicals, like Schuller's PPD, give off colorful reaction species when oxidized, not unlike how iron turns red when oxidized to rust. Darker hair colors are achieved by using a higher concentration of primary intermediates, while lighter dyes let hydrogen peroxide do most of the work. Whether you're a summer or winter or going all in for a cosplay, the primary intermediates also react with the dye's couplers to fine-tune and achieve that perfect shade. There are dozens of coupling compounds that can alter the exact tone, but we're not gonna split hairs here. Most are alcohols and amines that interact with primary intermediates to produce large, complex dye molecules. Dye companies usually mix and match couplers to achieve the intended tint and tone. Think of them like Bob Ross adding a happy little highlight to your luscious locks. And as a hair icon, he should know. Once the ammonia is washed out, the cuticle cells fall back into place and the dye molecules are locked in, leaving you with a glorious head of permanent color. Unfortunately, as the ammonia leaves the hair and the keratin layer reforms, the scaly cells may not fit together as neatly as before. This spells damage to your hair fibers and you might notice your locks are a bit more fragile. Swapping ammonia for alternative alkaline agents like ethanolamine may help prevent some of this damage, but may also limit the hues you can choose. Dyed hair can also be prone to dullness between touch-ups, primarily because free radical oxygens left behind in the dyeing process, or even released by the induction of the sun's UV rays, can degrade your new pigment and the hair cuticle itself. To fight this, some color-protecting shampoos contain antioxidants to help clear the free radicals and help keep that shine. But to keep that coif gram-worthy, you might also want to avoid chemicals that can shift your new hue. For example, blondes will want to steer clear of copper, often used as an anti-algae compound in swimming pools, which can oxidize their pigment to create a green tint. Yeah, I'm afraid that patina looks a lot cuter on the Statue of Liberty. Want more? We also get into the hairy details of shunning shampoo and explain why redheads may be more sensitive to pain. Thanks for watching, and be sure to like and subscribe on your way out. See you next week.